All right, so let's start and take a look at the first question. And this is the most viewed question in Stack Overflow since creation of this platform. And it has over 5.7 million views over the years. The question is, how do I convert a string to an int in Java? As you all know, strings are representations for text. And in usual text are characters like A, B, C, D, E and so on. But text can also be numbers or digits. Yeah. And if a string represents only a single number, there might be the use case that you want to convert the string into an integer or into a number. And in this case, in this question, the use case is to convert a string into an int. Java knows two different approaches to do this, and both approaches and both methods are located in the same class. It's in the integer class, you all know. And the first method you can use is a parseInt method. And the second one is the valueOf method of the integer class. So both methods get as parameter a string and converts it into a number. And the difference between both is that in the first case, the method returns a plain primitive int. And the second method, valueOf, returns a whole object, an integer object, a wrapper object of the primitive int. So, it costs much more working space for your computer to create integer than primitive int. So be aware of the fact if you want to convert 1,000 or 10,000 strings into a number, be aware of the fact that 10,000 integer are very or might be expensive for your computer, for your working storage. So in this case, I would prefer to use parseInt. But if you only want to convert one or two or three strings, it doesn't matter, in my opinion, what you are using regarding the working space. Huh? But if you need an integer object, you should use valueOf. If you are confident with only a primitive int, you should use parseInt method. Both methods can process either negative or positive numbers. So if your string s that you will pass in the method begins with minus sign, so a negative number, Java recognizes this and returns a negative number. So both is possible, negative and positive. As you can see, both methods throw the number format exception. So the number format exception is an unchecked exception. Unchecked exception is an exception that occurs and you don't have to process it. So you don't have to try catch it or your method and don't have to throw the exception and so on. So you don't have to process this, it. And but if you want to do this, you are able to do. And it depends on what your software looks like. So if you have, for example, a use case where you want a user to type in a number or with his keyboard and you want to continue by parsing the number into an int or in a number. So in this case, it would be useful to recognize if a number format exception occurs, because in this case, if you try, if you catch a number format exception, you will get or you will have the opportunity to ask the user again and say, sorry, user, you typed in a string wasn't a number, so please try again to give me a number. Yeah, so you can do this as long as you want and as long as you get the number or not the number. And so, yeah, it's up to you if you catch the number format exception. Yeah, but it's up to you because it is an unchecked exception. So both pass int and value of throw stem because, yeah, if your string isn't a number, then the both methods throw the number format exception. So let's take a look at the example. I have three different examples. The first one uses the parseInt method you see here. So as string, I pass a negative 16 as string. So everything is okay. This one is a negative number. It's okay. Java can process this or parse it into a number. So if you continue with the program, the value of number one, the int number one variable is minus 16. The second example is very easy too. It's the value of method. The string is the same. It's negative 16 and the integer.valueOf method returns an integer object. It's called number two in this case. And the third example, in this case, I will pass a string that isn't a correct number. So I doubled the negative, the minus sign, and Java detects this and throws a number format exception. I catch this in this case and print the stack trace of it. And as you can see, Java lang number format exception for input string minus minus 16 would be the message. So yeah, as you can see, in this case, you could have the opportunity to make something. You could make a default value if you want to convert the number and it isn't possible, maybe you will continue with the default value. Or you may ask the user again to type in the number again, or you have all opportunities, as you know. But as I said, you don't have to use try catch because the number format exception is an unchecked exception. This is how you can convert the string into an int or to an integer. And I would say, let's continue with the second question. The second most viewed question on Stack Overflow with over 4.2 million views is how do I declare and initialize an array in Java? You might know what an array is. An array is a special data structure to store different objects or different primitives in it. And each array has a fixed size. And in each array, you can address each element directly. So for example, if you have an array with the size 5, you can say, please give me the second element or the third or the fifth, and you can get it or you can edit them as you want. Yeah, and you can address each element of it. That is how the data structure array looks like. So if you want to create an array, you have three different approaches. The first one is that you create an empty array with a defined size. So if you don't know the content yet of the array, but you know you want an array of a size 5, you can use the first approach. Sometimes you have content and you want to create an array out of this content. So you can use the second one. So it's the creation of an array by defining its content. And the third approach is to create an array out of a stream from the stream API from Java 8. And each stream has a method to array. And in this case, you would convert the stream into an array. In this case, each stream is only one-dimensional, so the resulting array is also one-dimensional, but the two different approaches can also create multi-dimensional arrays. So you might know that arrays can have 2, 3, 4 dimensions. So you are free by creating them with two approaches. And yeah, we would see in an example that the size, if you are using the first approach, the size is defined and fixed in each dimension. But if you are using the creation over its content, the size or the element, the size of the elements in each dimension may differ. But don't worry, we take a look at an example. So in this case, in line 2 and line 3, we are using the first approach. So we don't have any content yet. We only know the size of the array. In this case, we want to create an array with size 5. So we can write the data type and the brackets, variable name, equal sign, new, data type, brackets, and then the size of the array. And what we get here isn't that empty at all, I have to be honest, because as you might know, only the primitive types aren't or can't be empty at all. So if you have an int variable, it always has a default value. The default value of int is 0. So what we get by writing the second line is an array of size 5, and every element, so the 5 element within this array are defined with the default value 0 from the int. But if you are using objects like this integer, the array is empty at all. So what you have here is an array with size 5 and 5 times null as content. So yeah, in this case you might say that you get an empty array, but the creation is the same. You know the size and you don't know yet the content, and you create an array out of a special size. If you have this for the second approach, if you know the content and you want to create an array out of the content, so you can use the creation type in line 4. The content in this case are 3 numbers, 1, 2, 3, and you can write it like this, and the result is an int array of size 3. So yeah, you don't have to write the size of it, you only have the content, and Java computes the size and so on and creates an array. And a pre-initialized array, so you have 4, 1, 2, 3 as content of the array. In line 5 is the same approach used, so the second one, but it's a bit shorter with the notation, but it's the same as in line 4. So line 4 and 5 is the same one, and line 5 is a bit shorter. All right. So let's take a look at the multidimensional arrays. So if you have, in our example, we have 2 dimensions. And if you want to use the first approach with a defined size, you can write it like this. And with an object like integer, like this. And if you have a content and you want to create an array out of the content, you can also do it with multidimensional arrays like you see in line 9. But as I said, the size of elements in a dimension may differ if you use the second approach. In the first approach, the size of each dimension is always the same. So as you can see, the first approach, the second dimension, the size of each element is 2. And the size of the first dimension is of each element is also 2. And if you use the second approach, the size may differ. Let's take a look at the example in line 10. There we see this. We have, in first dimension, we have three elements, 1, 2, and 3. And but the size of the three elements differ. So in the first, in the first case, we have the size 1. In the second case, 2. And this one is size 3. So as you can see, it's more flexible to write it this way than to use the first approach. Because in the first approach, if you would write, you have to write 3, 3. So you have three elements in the first dimension and the element has the size 3 in the second dimension. But yeah, you would have more elements than you want and then you need, because you want here only one size, while size 1, here size 2, and so on. So yeah, the two approaches differ, and that's the difference between. So the second approach is more flexible than the first one. Also, take notice of the different notations of arrays. So you might, or the usual way to define arrays is that you write a data type, and after the data type, the brackets, and then the variable name, and so on. But you can also only write the data type, then the variable name, and then the brackets. Yeah. So it's both fine for your Java. It's okay. But I would recommend you the notation in line 15, and it's the usual notation, because if you take a quick look on the code in line 15, you see, okay, it's an int array. In line 16, you might think, if you take only a quick look at the expression, you might think it's only an int because you don't recognize the brackets too fast. So, and then you think, oh, it's an int, and you are wondering why you have an array. So yeah, it's line 15, it's the usual one, and I would recommend you to use 15 as well for you. If you want to edit the arrays, as I said in the beginning, you can pick each element in the array and edit it, or you can change it, and so on. And as an example, how to process, how to iterate of an array, you could use for each or the for loop in this case, or for each, for example. But as you can see, I am using a for loop with the variable e for the first dimension. And the second loop, embedded loop, with the variable name j for the second dimension. So I pick each element of the first dimension int array I. Picks the I 0 at the beginning, so it picks the first element out of the array, and from this the length. So, and then after it, I can set a new value, for example, for it. So in this case, we start with number 0, and we set the first run would be int array 4 0 0 is the value 0. After that, we increment the variable number by 10, and after it would be 0, 1, 10, and so on. So you can iterate over the whole and through the whole array, and you can edit it, for example, or you can change the values, what you want to do with it. And as you can see, you can write the brackets, the variables in the brackets. If you want to read an array, it's the same. You override, you iterate through it, and then you can use a system out print line. For example, in this case, I use a string format, and if you write this percentage d, and d is it's a number, an integer number. So one, two, three, three parameters, and this is the first one, this is the second, this is the third one, and so, and you can then reading the whole array. If you do so, you get this as result. Yeah, the third approach was to create an array out of a stream. And for this approach, this example is here. So what do we do here? We create an int stream from 1 to 5. 5 is exclusive. And I call the toArray method on the stream. And I get an int array out of it. And I can iterate over it as I did before and get as result 1, 2, 3, 4. And to demonstrate that the size of elements may differ in one dimension, in the same dimension, if you are using the second approach, I have made this example. It's int array 5 underscore 2. And this one was this. So we have, as I said, in the first dimension, 3 elements. And the second dimension has different size. The first is 1. The second element has the size 2. The third element has the size 3. And if we iterate through this array, we can see the size of each element in the second dimension with it. And we get as result 1, 2, and 3. So, yeah, as I said. And then you can see that the length or the size of the dimension and the elements differ. So yeah, it's more flexible than the other one. Yeah, this is it. This is how you create and initialize an array. And I would say, let's take a look at the third question. The third most viewed question on Stack Overflow with over 3.8 million views over the years is, how do I generate random integers within a specific range in Java? So yeah, it's a usual use case to generate random numbers. Wherever you need random things, you can manage them by random integers or random numbers. So it's a use case that is very often, I would say. The central class for random things is javautil random class. And this class has different methods to generate random things. So in general, it's random numbers, and you have the opportunity to create different data types of numbers. So for example, you can create a random ints, random doubles, random longs, and so on. But as the name random suggests, it isn't random numbers or something like this, but just random. So you have the opportunity to generate, for example, random booleans, as you can see here, boolean, and there is a method called next boolean, and it creates random booleans. So if you need random booleans, this class is also your friend, not only for numbers. And yeah, let's have a look at the next int method. It returns only an int, and this method creates an int within the whole range of the data type int. So it's it's very big, and you can produce a random integer, a random int in the whole range of this data type with this method. And if you need an integer within a specific range, a defined range, that's the question, you should use the next int with int as parameter, this one. So I call the parameter bound in our case. And if you do so, you get an integer returned, a random integer returned by with this in this range. Zero is inclusive and bound is exclusive. Yeah. So in this range, you get 1. And be aware of the parameter bound. If you pass a bound with zero in this example, in this method, you get a range zero inclusive and zero exclusive. So there isn't a range in the world with this numbers. So it would throw an illegal argument exception if you pass a zero or a less than zero in this method. So be aware of it and always pass a one or a greater or bigger than one into it. And then you get such a random integer. If you need a random floating point number, for example, a double, then you should use the next double method on its own. If you use it on its own, next double, you get a random double within the range of 0 to 1. So this is what you get if you call next double. And if you need a double within a specific range, for example, from 0 to 50, you have to multiply this random generated double with the bound, as a bound should be integer in this case. And for example, bound should be 50. And the resulting number, floating point number, the resulting double in this case, would be in the range of 0 and 50, both inclusive. So let's take a look at an example. We create us an instance of the random class with using the default constructor. And after that, we call it we use the random instance and call the next int with a given I as variable in it. And we increment the I every loop over the for loop and by 10. And we then output first the range and after it the computed random integer, or I say integer, but I mean the primitive int data type. So that's for sure only an example. We are computing random numbers, so they are random. If you would try it on your own, you have different numbers for sure. But as you can see, the range is set. So in this case, we have the maximum 20 and so on. So that would be the thing with integers. And if you want to use random doubles, you can, as I said, you should use random.nextDouble and multiply it with another int, for example. If you need a double within a bigger range than 0 and 1. And in our case, we are using as the same range as above. Multiply it with next double. And as you can see, it works very well and it do what we want. So we create a random double in this case within a specific range. You might see or you might know the computation of random usual with the math class and the random method. You can see it in many, many times in other codes. And if you take a look what happens there at the random method within the math class, it's interesting. Internally, it is using just the random class. And if you call the random method, the math class invokes the next double method on the intern random instance. Yeah? So the technique of creating random doubles within the math class is exactly the same as we see it before, with the limitation that random is only from 0 to 1 for sure, like the method next double. Yeah, but it's the same one. So if you see this one, you can remember, okay, it's a random class, and random class is the most flexible one to do so to random things. If you are writing an application that uses several threads and more than one thread needs a random number, you should think about if you would use the same random instance. Random class itself is thread safe, so it stands also in the Java API, but you could face performance degradation if you use the same instance within different or with different threads. So let's take a look at the API. There it is, instances of random are thread safe. Okay, so you could use it if you want, but however, the concurrent use of the same random instance across threads may encounter contention and consequent poor performance. Consider instead using thread local random in multi-threaded designs. So yeah, it may be leads to a poor performance or poorer performance, and consider instead of using the thread local random class. So let's take look at an example, and for this we go to the Eclipse, and I just opened the question 3.yama, and the class thread local random that is suggested for this is an extension of the random class, so itself. So random this one. And if you are in a multi-threaded application, you should or could use the thread local random. And as you can see, it's an instance of random. So the same methods are provided and so on, but yeah, with a better performance. So let's try it out, the performance difference. So what do we do here? We have a fixed thread pool, or a thread pool with a fixed size with 100 threads. And for this 100 threads, we have 1 million times the task to create an integer, a random integer. So we have above here an instance of random, of a random class. And with this random class, or on this random class instance, we are calling the next int method. And this one, 1 million times. So it creates 1 million random ints with 100 threads concurrently. And in this, we take the timestamps before, so here. Then we invoke all the callables, all 1 million tasks at once, and we are waiting the method invoke all waits till the computation of 1 million random integers or random numbers is done, and after that we take a look about on the difference between this timestamp and now, and the difference in millis. So after that we do the same with 100 threads. We empty the callables array list, and then again 1 million tasks, but we are using the thread local random class. And you, as you can see, you should use it, or you have to use it with the current method. And you can call the next int method like above, but not as here with the same random instance, but the thread local random. And yeah, as we did before, we are taking the timestamp here, we compute all, invoke all, and after that we compare the difference between the both. And let's have a look. All right, so you can see the difference in this case isn't too big, and that big, well, it's, let's have another look. Okay, here it is the half of the time, so it's an impressive difference. Here again, okay, but as I said, or as I showed you in the API, that it may encounter poor performance. It don't have to. It only may. So it is possible that the second approach is sometimes it is slower than the first one. Now. All right. So the first one using or sharing the random instance is in this case faster than using thread local random. But as you can see, mostly of the runs, the performance of the first approach is slower than on the second one. So it's a recommendation. You don't have to do it, but yeah, you don't have to do it because random is thread safe, but you may think about it to use it in multi-threaded applications. All right, that's the question, or that's the explanation of the question, how you generate random numbers, random integers, random doubles within Java. The fourth most viewed question on Stack Overflow with over 3.7 million views over the years is, how do I compare strings in Java? So yeah, the comparison between strings is special, but in general, it is interesting, how can I compare two objects with each other? And Java knows two different comparisons, two different kinds of comparisons. And so, yeah, you have two different approaches to compare two strings, or in general, two objects with each other. And we want to take a look at both. So the first approach is the equality operator. It is written with two equal signs, and the equality operator compares two references with each other. We'll take a look what it does exactly. And the second one is the equals a call of the equals method of an object. So the equals method is part of the class object, and in Java every kind of class is extending the object class. So every object, every kind of data type in Java has the equals method, because equals method is part of the object class. Okay. And with the equals method, you check the content of two objects. So you compare the content, not the references of it. So let's have a look how Java works. As I said, with the equality operator, you can compare two references with each other if they are pointing on the same object on the heap. So let's take a look what this means. I have created an example. In line 3, we are creating an object with a string with the content hello world and a reference string s1. So s1 is pointing to an object with the content hello world. And if you create an object in Java, every created object is stored in the heap of your computer, of your working storage. Yes? All right. So, yeah, this call creates an object in the heap. I called it string1. It's a pseudo name with the content hello world. And s1 is a reference to this object. So s1 is pointing to this object. In line 4, I create another reference called string s2 and say s2 equals s1. And what it does is that s2 is pointing to the same object as s1. Okay? So as you can see in Java, on the left side, there are only references which are pointing to objects or to other, to objects or to null. We see it later. And the objects are in the heap. And in this case, after computing line 4, it looks like that S1 and S2 is pointing on the same object. So it's the reference is the same. So if you compare the references with the equal operator, it says true. So S1 equal operator S2 is true. Okay? Because S1 and S2 is pointing to the same object. So the reference is the same. So if we continue with our code and we write s2 equals new string hello world, what happens in the heap is it creates a second object pseudo called string2 with the same content, but the object is another one. So we have two different objects, string1 and object string2, but they have the same content, but are different objects. And with this call in line 2, the reference s2 isn't pointing to object 1 anymore, but now it is pointing to object 2. So it looks like this. And now, if I am checking with the equality operator, if S1 and S2 is the same reference, it says false. Yeah. Okay. It makes sense because they are not pointing on the same object anymore. And it is the content of the object is it doesn't matter here. It is all only looking at the references. If you want to compare the content of the objects, you have to use the equals method. So that's the second approach to compare strings in Java or objects. As I said, there are two different kinds of comparison. Now we are looking at the second approach. The second approach takes a look at the content of two objects. And in this case, if we are looking at our example that we just saw, so we create S1 and S2 points on the same object like S1. The content is the same for sure. S1 equals S2 is true. Clear. And if I create then another string object with also hello world as content, and I create I ask is S1 equals S2, and it says also true because the content is the same. Yeah, let's have a look at what has happened here. So we, in our case, we are using the string class. So go to navigate, open type, then we type string, Java string. And there must be an equals method. You can go quick outline, and then you can type equals. And then you see, okay, this is the implementation of the equals method from class string. Let's have a quick look at an object. We go to navigate, open type, object. And as you can see, object has equals 2. Yeah, and that's the default implementation of equals. So it compares the instance where the equals method is called. And then it compares, is this, the instance, the same reference as the given object? So it are both references are pointing on the same object? If yes, so equals is also true. So the content is the same. Clear. And yeah, this kind or this method is an overriding this the equals method from object, and it's a bit confusing, but it compares the value of the string, and value, you can see it here, value is used for character storage. So in this variable the text value of the string is stored, and in the equals method the value of the instance and the value of an object, in this case an object is instead of string, so a string is cast, an object is cast to string, and then the value from this one and this is compared with each other. So yeah, you will see the equals method is looking at the content of objects. If you are writing an own data type, you can override the equals method, and you can say or you can define when two different objects are the same content regarding the content by overriding the equals method. Okay. So beware of null pointer exceptions. If you are having data types like strings or any kind of objects that are not primitives, you can initialize them by with null. And if you are asking or checking the references, is S3 equals S4 or the equality operator, it says true. Yeah, for sure, and both are null references. But if you are looking at S3 dot equals S4, it gets null pointer exception. So why? S3 is null, and you aren't allowed to invoke methods on null. If you try to, you get a null point exception. There is later on, I think the question number 9 is handling with null point exceptions and how to avoid and how to fix it. So let's have a look later on this issue. But for now, you have to be aware you can't always call the equals method on each object, because the object may be null. So yeah, be aware of the null pointer exception in this case. Since Java version 7, there is a class called objects, And this class has a equals method on its own, and it's a null pointer exception safe, I called it. Why? If it checks if A is null. So let's have a look how it works. You ask the class, is object A and object B, or the reference from type object A and the reference of type object called B, is it the same or equals, has the same content? So it says, okay, if A is pointing to the same object as B, it is true for sure. If it is not the same reference, then this is one is or, then it evaluates this expression. And first it take a look if A is not equal null. And if this is the case, then A dot equals B is called. Is A null? Then this one isn't called anymore. To get rid of the null pointer exception. And so you see, if you want to use the equals method and you don't want to get a null pointer exception, or you don't want to have the dangerous of a null pointer exception, use the objects class, objects.equals, and give both objects in it, and it is null pointer exception safe, as you can see. Comparing strings with each other is a bit special and a bit confusing at the beginning, and that's why I think the question is how I compare strings in Java with each other, and not how do I compare objects with each other, because in the case of strings there is a bit confusion because of the string pool, the so-called string pool. What is the string pool? You can initialize strings in two different ways. Like you can write it like in line 2, for example, without using a constructor. And you can create a string like in line 3 with a constructor. If you are using the expression without constructor, you get a string with the same content as in S7. Yeah? But if you are using this one, the string object you get, or the reference is pointing to a string object that isn't in the heap, but it is in the string, so-called string pool. So every time you create or you are using such a string without using a constructor, Java is creating an object of class string and lays it in the string pool for reusability. So if you are using later on the same string without calling the constructor, Java looks in the string pool and sees, there is already a string with this content, so I could reuse it and I give it back to the same reference. So if you are writing S5 and S6, they are pointing to the same object within the string pool. So yeah, if you think you are using, for example, 100 times hello world, why, whatever, but you are using it. And if there weren't a string pool, Java had to create 100 times an object of type string with the same content. And with the string pool, it has only created one object and gave away 100 reference to the same object. So that's why the string pool, or that's the background of the string pool. So yeah, by calling S5 and S6 both the same way, if we compare those, the reference, we get true as result. So they are pointing to the same object within the string pool, but you can explicitly create a new object on the heap, and you can say, I don't want to use the object of the string pool, I want my own object. And if you do so, or if you want to do so, you should use the constructor of class string. And if you do, if you write new string hello world, Java doesn't use the string pool, it uses the constructor and creates a new string object on the heap with the same content like the object in the string pool. But that's the reason why, if you compare the reference between S6 and S7, it says false. So that's the special thing regarding the strings. So if you don't know the string pool, and then you would think, okay, I create an object here, create an object there, so there are two different objects. Why is this reference true? Why is the reference the same? The answer is because Java is using a string pool, and now you are aware of this kind of comparison, and you understand why this is the same. That's the special thing about the string pool. All right, that's so far the comparison between two strings in Java, or in general, the comparison between two objects in Java. Let's have a look at the next question. The fifth most viewed question is how to split a string in Java, and it has more than 3.6 million views. The use case of it is very usual. So you get one single string, for example, a phone number, and you want to split it into different parts, into different strings. So you want to extract the language number and so on, or you get an email address as one string and you want to extract the provider, the language, the last two characters and or the name and so on. So you get one string and you want to split it into different strings. In Java, there is one main method for this approach or for this issue, and it is located within the string class itself, and the method is called split. And as you can see, it's an instance method, so you call it on a special instance of string, and you give it as parameter, you give a regular expression, and this regular expression describes how to split the string on which instance you called the method. And the result of the splitting is returned by a string array with the different parts in it after the splitting. So let's have a look how it works. So first of all, we are using a pattern class here with an email pattern. So it's a regular expression describing an email address, the look of an email address, and the source of this regular expression is here. Why am I using the pattern? I want just to show you how it could work. First check before I split the string, I first check if my given string matches the regular expression of an email address. So if you want to split an email address, maybe It is good for you if you know how to first how to check. Do I have an email address here? Does my given string match the pattern of an email address? So yeah, before you split, maybe you want to take a look if the given string matches the pattern. So if you do so, you could use the pattern class. My email address that I want to split is stored in the variable string s. And what I am doing here is I have my pattern instance with the regular expression. It's case insensitive. It's a very nice class to describe patterns. And then I can call matcher and give the matcher my string. Matcher itself, it's an own class. Let's have a look. Pattern. I don't want to use shortcuts, so I go navigate open type and Java util regex pattern. And if you are calling the matcher, then you get a matcher class. And yeah, the pattern itself has a regular expression. You check if the input matches the regular expression. And to do so, you get a matcher instance. And on this matcher instance, you can call, for example, find, attempts to find the next subsequence of the input sequence that matches the pattern. So yeah, maybe you have a string given with different email addresses and you can use then the pattern for email addresses. You pass the string with the several email addresses in, you get a matcher, and then you can call on this matcher find and you get Boolean true, 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 as long as you have different email addresses and so on. Yeah, so this is how you could use the matcher, but we want to take a look how to split the string in here. So we do find the pattern of regular expression and my given string is okay. It matches, so we are in here. And then I call the split method on my given string s. And this is a regular expression. I don't want to explain the regular expression is here. It's very tricky and very complex, as you can see above. But let me tell you, in this case, I am splitting only on the character at. So the brackets here means character. All right, and if I do so, I split on the at sign, I get the first part and the second part as result. So let's have a look. Here is the one at the system out print line and the result is 1, 1, Hans Mustermann and the second gmail.com. So as second try, I am using two different characters split at the at sign or at the dot sign. So a dot character. So if we do so, we get as result four different parts. The first part would be Hans, the second one Mustermann, then the split is with the at sign, then Gmail, then com. You can see it here. And you can also use another approach, not using the string split method, is the pattern class itself has also a split method. Let's take a quick look. quick outline, split, different things, different methods, and yeah, it works exactly the same like the split class on string. You get you pass an input and you get a string array out of it. So yeah, we have our email address pattern here. Or no, not the email address pattern, but we make a new pattern by invoking the compile method and the add. So our pattern is now only one regular expression with the add sign. And on this, I can input my string, and this string is splitted with this regular expression given here. So yeah, we split the same way like here above with the add sign, and the result is two elements, Hans Mustermann at gmail.com. Yeah, so that's how you split a string. It's very simple. If you want to split easy things like only an add sign or something like this, but as you can see, you can pass regular expressions. Regular expressions itself is very complex and sometimes annoying issue. So, and yeah, it's very, very powerful, the method. And you can, with pattern, with matcher and so on, you can make very, very interesting and crazy things. All right, that's it for this question. So let's see us in the next question. Let's have a look at the sixth question with also over 3.6 million views over the years, and it is iterate through a hash map. Let's first have a look, what is a map? A map is an interface, as you can see here, located in the Java util package, and a map is an amount of key value pairs or a set of key value pairs. And as every set is unordered, so a map is not ordered. And so you have a set of several key value pairs. And as you can see, a map is generic with two parameters. The first one is the value or the data type of the keys with K. And the second one is the data type for values. And each key value pair is called entry, and each entry is described by a sub interface. It's an interface located in the interface map, and it is called Java util map entry. So let's have a look. Sorry, close all. So let's quickly open the interface map, and yeah, you can use it, a map entry, key value pair and so on, and every entry has get key, get value and so on, comparing methods and so on. So, but it's only an interface, so it's a description of it. And yeah, every map, like hash map and other maps, we take a look after it, which maps consists and so on. But every map, regardless which implementation of map, has three different ways to iterate through it. So the first way is to iterate through all entries. It's the method entry set, is it located here? And you get, as result, you get a set, so it is unordered, as I said. And if you want each key value pair on its own, you have to use the entry set method, then you get a set as result of the entries. So, but if you only want to iterate over the keys of the map, so you don't want to see the values and the key value pairs itself, you only want the keys, then you could use the key set method and you get a set of the type K for the keys. And if you want only to see the values, you could use the values method to get a collection of type V. So yeah, it depends what you want. If you iterate over the or through the entries of the key value pairs, you have to do this. And for each entry, you can ask the entry, please give me your key, or please give me your value, or you only iterate over the keys or the values, yeah, as you want. So the question is, iterate through a hash map. I think the question would be better, iterate through a map, because it doesn't matter if you have a hash map, a tree map, a link map, whatever. The iteration through a map is always the same, because the necessary methods that you need to iterate through the whatever map are placed in the interface map. So the question could be, iterate through a map. It doesn't matter if it is a hash map or something like this. But as I write here, I think hash map is maybe the most used implementation of map. So there are different kind of maps, but yeah, the hash map is maybe the most used map on its own. So yeah, let's have a quick look. What maps do we have opened? So you can mark the word map, and then you go to F4, open type hierarchy, and then you get the type hierarchy of map, or you can go navigate, open type in hierarchy, and then you can type map in it, and you hit the enter key. I go here. Yeah, and as you can see, on the root is the map interface, and there are different other implementations of the map. For example, the abstract map, and the abstract map on its own has a bunch of implementations or extensions, and you can see the hash map here. So as I showed in the script here, hash map is an extension of abstract map, and here the object. And the abstract map itself is, as the name suggests, is an abstract class, but it's an implementation of the map interface. So there are a few things like the simply entry class that implements the entry interface of map, and the abstract map itself, as I said, is an implementation of the map, and so on. And so then the hash map is another special implementation of the abstract or extension of the abstract map. But for example, you couldn't find another implementation for the entry itself. So the hash map uses the implementation of entry from abstract map. But as you can see, there are a few different things. It is using the hash code to store the things in it. That's why the name hash map is come from. But yeah, as I said, the iteration, how you iterate through a map, it doesn't it doesn't matter if it is a hash map or whatever. So let's Have a look at an example for iterating through a map. I have written a method, iterate through a map. It's a static one, so I don't need an instance of the class. And I have a as parameter, I have a map with two question marks. So regardless which data type it is, the key value doesn't matter. I just want to system out println them. I want to, or I want to iterate through. So it doesn't matter if the key is in string, an integer, whatever, doesn't matter. So I have a map and I am using the for each loop here, and I call map.entrySet, and this returns the whole entry set as we saw here, the whole set of entries of the map. And for each map.entry element, I can make something with each entry. And for this one, I output the get key and the get value. So first the key, then the value, and this looks like this string. And as you can see, it doesn't matter which concrete implementation you are using, if you are using a hash map, a tree map, or whatever. You just saw how many implementations the interface map have. And yeah, in this case, I'm using the hash map. I fill the hash map with several inputs and call the iterate through map and get as output this below. After that, I am creating a tree map and fill it with elements and iterate through and call the method with the tree map, and it also iterates through the map. Yeah. So that's how the iteration on maps work and how, what a map especially is, what is the interface, and what is a hash map, and so on. And yeah, this is it. Let's have a look at the next question. All right, the seventh question with over 2.8 million views is initialization of an array list in one line. What does this question mean? Is how can I create an array list? And after creation, how can I fill this array list with data in only one line of code? And let me tell you that there isn't a short way to do this with the array list class itself. So we need a little hack, and the hack would be to use a constructor of the array list class that gets a collection. So we have to create a collection in one line and pass this collection into the constructor of the array list, and the result is an array list filled with the data out of this collection. So the first question would be, how can I create a collection in one line and fill it with data also with one single call in one line? So the API knows various ways to create collections in one line. But yeah, I show you the most common ones. The most common one maybe is the second approach I showed you here. So it is to use the arrays class and the method as list, you see there, the method. What does this method, or a call to this method, do? You see the parameter is a var arg parameter, so you can pass as many of elements you like in there. So you can pass only one or two or three parameter, how many you want. And the result of the call of the method is a list with this parameters inside. So with this method, you are able to call or to create a list with only one call in one line. And all elements you want in this list, you can pass simply to this method. And as you all know, every list is a collection. So you can also say that a call of this method get or creates a collection in only one line. The second approach would be to call the list interface itself, and the methods of this list interface, there are methods of, it creates an empty list, or of E, it creates a list with only one parameter, or with one element, sorry, or this method, and so on. There are a few methods in the list interface to create a list. But as you can see, you only get a list as result, and list, as we all know, is an interface. So you get a special implementation of the list. It isn't a normal, usual error list or something like that. But yeah, there are special lists, if you want to say this. So I write it here. These methods don't return error list, but special implementations of the list interface. So let's take us a look what they do, especially. So if you are using the list of method to create a list, you get special lists in form of unmodifiable lists. So the result would be an implementation of the list interface, but the list is unmodifiable. So you aren't allowed to remove elements, you aren't allowed to add elements, you aren't allowed to edit the elements in this list. There might be use cases in which you have to be sure that your list, once you created it, can't be modified at all at the end. So yeah, if you need such a list, this method or this methods of the list interface are your friends. The second one, arrays.sList method, also creates a special list, and let's take us a look at the API for this. So we go to navigate, open type, and we call the arrays class, and in this we are looking for the method quick outline as list. And what it creates is an array list, but it's not an usual array list. It is this special kind of array list. So if you mouse over it, you can see it too. Java util arrays.arrayList.arrayList. So yeah, you don't get an usual array list, as we all know. This array list Java util array list. But you get a special implementation, and the special implementation is in the class ArrayList, in the class ArrayList itself contained. So yeah, the class Arrays class provides its own ArrayList implementation, if you like to do it, to say it this way. And what it is special, it is the returned list from the asList method is a fixed size list. So you aren't allowed to remove elements, and you aren't allowed to add elements to the returned list, we take a look at an example later on, so we could see how it works in special. And why is the list fixed size? You can imagine the method to build a bridge between this var args. Every var args parameter is in the end is an array. So you can pass there an array and you get a list out of this array. And this list and this array is connected with each other. So if you edit the list, you are allowed to edit the list, but not edit with you aren't allowed to add or to remove elements, but you can change, you can edit the containing elements. And if you change anything, any element of the list, the array is edited as well. And if you edit an element of the array, so the list element is also edited. Yes? So it is, you can imagine this method like a bridge between this array and this list. So they are connected with each other. And if you change one element on the one side, the other element on the other side is also changed. So when do you need such a method? Sometimes you get from the one API, from the one side, you get an array, and on the other side, you have a list, or you need a list. And if you want to connect both sides with each other, you could use this. Because if you would copy the array on the one side and copy into a list, and you pass the list to the other side, they aren't connected anymore. So if the array is changing, the list didn't recognize this, and vice versa. So if you want to connect them and live, and they stay in touch with each other, you can use this method. So it's very tricky and very special, this implementation. But you can use it, as I said, simply for create a collection in one line. So you don't need to use the special connection between the array and the list. Yeah, you can use it only for easy purpose to create a collection in one line. And if you did it this way or this way, you get as a result a list and a collection. And then you can use this constructor. So let us take a look in this class. Where is the constructor? This one. And that's the only constructor you can see where you can pass multiple elements in it. This not, you can only with an initial capacity. On an empty array list, and this is the only way to create an array list by using the constructor and to fill the same array list in one line, yeah, by passing the collection in the constructor itself. Yeah, and then the array list is the collection is, you can see, is copied or is filled into the created array list itself. So this is the way how you can initialize and fill an array with data in only one line. So let's take a look at an example for this. And in the first line, I create a list with or by using the off method of the list interface, and I am passing two strings to this method, and the result is I get an unmodifiable list of type string. And yeah, as I said, an unmodifiable list, you aren't allowed to add or to remove something, and you aren't allowed to change the elements. So it isn't also it isn't allowed to use the set method. You can at every list there is the set method here. So you say at position index you set please the new element. So you aren't allowed to use the set method, the add or the remove method. And if you try to do this, you get an Java lang unsupported operation exception. But you can use it to create simply a list or a collection, and you can pass then the collection into the error list of constructor, and the result is a normal error list. So let's take a look at this. So we first create an unmodifiable list by calling the off method from the list interface, pass it to the array list constructor, and the result is a normal array list. We are allowed to add something, to remove something, and so on. So yeah, you get a usual array list as result. The second approach would be to use the arrays.sList method. So we are passing also two elements to it, hello and world, and as you just saw, the array as list element parameter is a var arg, so it is converted to an array, string array in this case of size 2, but yeah, it isn't doesn't matter how it works, but this would be an array, and the array is connected with the resulted list, so it is fixed size as I just explained. And fixed size does only mean that you aren't allowed to remove or to add something, but you are allowed to edit the elements or to change the elements. So I am allowed to set a new element on the zero place. So in this case, new hello, a string, it is okay. And if I try to remove an element, I get also the unsupported operation exception as here in the example before. So it's also a special kind of list, but I can use it as creator of a collection, and the collection I can pass to the array list as well. And after it, I am allowed to add and to remove the elements as I usually want to do if I'm using an array list. Yeah, so this would be the way to create and to fill an array list in only one line. The eighth question with over 2.7 million views is how do I create a file and write to it in Java? And as you might suggest, also here there are different approaches to do this. And the simplest approach, if you want only to create a file in your file system, is to use the create new file method from the class file. What is instance of file or an instance of the class file? It isn't necessarily a real file in your file system, but it is an abstraction of a file or a directory in your file system. So you can create such an instance by passing a name for the file or a path name. So if you want to create a file in a special folder, so you can pass it to the constructor and the name of the file later on. But if you only create an instance, it doesn't exist necessarily in the file system. So it's only an abstraction of such an entry in your file system. But if you want to create such a file in the file system, you just have to create first an instance of the file class, and then you should call the create new file And then after it, it is created, if it is possible, your operation system or your file system may say that you don't have the rights to write there a file or something like that. There are many scenarios because a file isn't possible to write there or to create there. So yeah, you the method might throw an IO exception, and you get also a boolean if it worked to create a file or not. But the result of this method is, as I said, an empty file with the size of 0 bytes. The question here is, how do I create a file and to write to it in Java? And there are mainly two different approaches. The first one is to use the file output stream class, and the second one is to use the print writer class. So where's the difference between them? Both are data streams who are writing or which are writing to the files, datas to the files. So they do the same thing, but the file output stream is on the layer of bytes. So you can say this byte and this byte, I want to write it to this file, please. And the print writer, as the name might suggest, writes strings or text forms, characters to the file. So if you want to create a text file which the user is able to read afterwards, you can for sure use the file output stream as well, because every file consists of bytes in the IT. But it would be easier to use the print writer because you don't have to manage the encryption and so on. So the print writer helps you a lot by writing strings to a file or text to a file, and but sometimes you only want to put only bytes into a file, and if you do so, the file output stream is your friend. So maybe there is a scenario where you get if you might copy a picture, for example. So you can use a file input stream, and the file input stream would read byte after byte after byte of this image. Yeah, so you create a file input stream with a file that points to this image, and then you can read byte by byte by byte from the file input stream, and then you pass each byte you just read to the file output stream and write it to another file. And if both streams are finished, yeah, you've copied the image file. So yeah, an image, you couldn't write an image by text for sure. If you want to write an image, you have to use bytes. But you can also get the bytes from a network connection or something like this. So file output stream is your friend to write bytes. How does it work? You get an instance of file class. So it is, as I said, it might be only an abstraction to a real file. It doesn't have to exist. And if it don't exist, the file output stream would create it at your file system first. And there might be exceptions. If you are, for example, your file instance is pointing to a directory, and the file output stream isn't able to write data into a directory. And if you try to do this, you get, for example, file not found exception. So let us take a look. There are many things where the file not found exception may occur. So we are using the file output stream, and this constructor, and as you can see, file not found. If the file exists but is a directory rather than a regular file, or does not exist but cannot be created or cannot be opened for any other reason. So yeah, there are this three opportunities why you get a file not found exception during using the constructor. So, but if everything works, the file would be created in your file system, and after it you have a file output stream that is pointing to this file, and you can then write bytes to it. And you can do this by using, for example, the write byte array method. So you can pass a whole byte array to it, and it is written to the file. Or you can use, for example, if you have only one single byte, you can use the write int method, and the int one, the int is meant that you would pass a byte to it. So let's have a look. This int b is the byte to be written. Yeah. So this would be a way if you want to write bytes in it. If you have text that you want to create, or if you want to pass text into a file, you could use the print writer. The print writer is working pretty much the same as the file output stream. So you are passing a file instance to the constructor. You also can get file not found exception for the same reasons. And then you have, if you have once created a print writer instance, you can, for example, use, there are plenty of methods. You can use print line a string x, so the string is printed into the file, and then the line is broken into a new line. Or if you don't want to have a new line after the string, you can use the print method. And as you can see, you can also print integers, print long, print float, boolean, and so on, print object, and so on, yeah, or print f, print formatted, and so on. So yeah, this would be the way to do this if you want to create and write text to a file. So let's take a look at an example of this. The first example would be only the create new file method from the file class. So as you can see, we are calling new file with the path name. It's using the root directory from your Java application. So the file would named empty file, and you create new file method, and the result is simply creates an empty file with size of 0 bytes. If you are using a file output stream, it could look in this, like this, new file output stream. You pass an instance of new file with the file output stream test as path name, and then you create a file output stream. This kind of try catch statement is called try with resource statement. So every stream has to be closed at the end. And if you are using the file, the try with resource statement, you don't have to close the stream at the end on your own, because the try with resource statement closes the stream. So it's very elegant to use this. And yeah, you create a file output stream called out, and we create a byte array with the size of 5, and we write this byte array to the stream, and the result would be a file with size of 5 bytes. Yeah. And in the last example would be the print writer, also with a new file instance, print writer test. And as I said, the print writer is to use it for to use to print text. And text might be not every single char is not one byte at the size of one byte and so on. It depends what character encoding you are using and so on. So the print writer has many opportunities to set encodings and so on. So it's very elegant to use it if you want to have strings. And so if you only create a certain print writer, it uses the default encoding and so on. And what am I doing here is, first of all, I am writing a string hello. After it, I only print or break the line into a new line. After that, I have the string world. I create a character and stream of characters out of it. And on this stream, I am calling the for each method, and for every character in the string world, it is written with the writer print line, and then I convert the character to a string. And the result would looks like this. So you have the word hello, the word hello, and after it the word world, and for each character in a new line. So the result is 16 bytes, but we have only how many characters? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and a few line breaks. But as you can see, there are more bytes than characters and line breaks and so on, because the encoding and as I said, each character is, maybe some characters are bigger than one byte, some characters are the size of one byte and so on. But you don't have to be able to do this on your own, because the print writer helps you, and the print writer is your friend by using text or to passing text in files. And yeah, that's the way you can create and write data, bytes, or text in a file. The ninth question with over 2.5 million views is, what is a null point exception and how do I fix it? The question would be better if it was, what is a null point exception and how do I avoid it? Because you have to avoid null point exceptions. And when a null pointer exception occurred, there's usually nothing to fix anymore. So yeah, avoid null pointer exceptions. What is a null pointer exception? A null pointer exception occurs if you are trying to call or to invoke a method on a null reference. And what a null reference is, we take a look now. And we take a look how references in general works. So let us take a look at the example here. If we call object O1 equals new object. So this statement creates an object on the heap. If you create an object, Java always creates them on the heap. It's a part of your working storage. And in the heap, the objects are stored and created. And yeah, new object creates an object on the heap, and you say the object O1 is the reference, and this reference points on the object 1 on the heap. If you then call a statement object O2, equals new object, then it creates a second object on the heap, and in a second reference called O2, and the object O2, the reference object O2 points on the object 2 on the heap. Then you can say, you can just create references by saying object O3 equals O1. What does this do? You create a new reference, O3, and it is pointing to the same object on the heap as a reference O1. So object 01 and object 03 are pointing on the same object, as you can see here on the image. In this example, every three references are pointing to the same object on the heap, and object 2 doesn't have any references anymore. And so in this case, the garbage collector is able to clean object 2 up, to clean it up, because there isn't a reference anymore on the object. And yeah, this is saying that this object isn't used anymore by the application, and then the garbage collector can clean it up if it wants. So at the next example, there is object 04 equals null. Yeah, you can create a reference that isn't pointing to an object on the heap, but it is pointing on null, on nothing, on null. And if you do so, you have a so-called null reference. And if you do a call on 04, if you try to invoke the toString method of object, for example, you can say 01.toString, then the object 1 is printed out in string form. And if you do 04.toString, then you get a null pointer exception, because 04 is a null reference. Here is an example of how to do this, how to provoke a null pointer exception. The example above is like on this slide. So we have 04 equals null, and 01, 02, 03 are all pointing to the same object. So we are calling the toString method, and we see that all three references are pointing to the same object. That's the same hash code of the object. So if you try on your own at home, the hash code is a different one. Each object has an own hash code. So, but you see that all three references are pointing to the same object. And so now we are trying to invoke the toString method on the 04 reference. And because of 04 is pointing to null, it is a null pointer. You get a null pointer exception. Yeah, that's how to provoke, or how null pointer exceptions are created. And the question now is how to avoid a null pointer exception. And yeah, there isn't one single answer to this question, because as I wrote here, null pointer exceptions may occur everywhere where references are used, because yeah, references may be null references, and if you call or invoke a method on a null reference, you get a null pointer exception. And so everywhere where you are working with references, and this is quite everywhere in your code, there may occur null pointer exceptions. So there isn't one single answer to how avoid null pointer exceptions. But most commonly or usual use case for references and where null pointer exceptions occur or may occur is when you are using writing methods. So like in this example, we have a method convert to upper string that gets a string s, and it returns a string. And we try to invoke the method to uppercase on the string s. And what to uppercase does is that every single character of the string is converted to an uppercase character. And this is then converted by the method. And yeah, the danger of this method is that you get a null pointer exception, because string s says only it is a reference to a string object, but it may be a null reference. And if you don't check if s is a null reference, and you always would call s dot to uppercase, you may have a null pointer exception, yeah? Because this may be a null reference. And to avoid it in this example, you could or you should ask if s equals equals null. So if s is a null pointer, a null reference, if yes, you can do anything. For example, you may throw the new illegal argument exception and say argument may not be null, or you could return a default string or something like this, or you can return null, for example, if s null, then you return null and not the uppercase version of s, and so on. So yeah. But what you want to do is up to you, but this is how you could avoid null pointer exception. And as I said, this kind of use case where a method gets parameters is usually and commonly where null pointer exceptions occur. Yeah, this is it. The 10th question, also with over 2.5 million views, is how does the Java for each loop work? And let's start with what isn't for each loop. For each loop is a syntactical abbreviation. It supersedes the explicit use of the iterator of a given data structure. So let's think about the use case. You have a data structure like a list, an array, or something like this that stores several elements, and you want to iterate over each element of this data structure. And before the for each loop and was announced in Java 5, you had to use always the iterator. And the iterator is an object to iterate through this data structure element by element by element and so on until you get to the end of the data structure and there aren't any more elements to iterate through. So let's take a look at the code before the for each loop was announced. So you had to create an iterator. This object you want is the data structure we want to iterate through. So it is called some iterable, and we call dot iterator. And this method returns an iterator. In our case, some iterable is of the type string. So the elements of the data structure are strings. So the iterator is also of the type string. And then we ask the iterator dot has next. So you are asking the iterator, do you have a next element to iterate through? And if the iterator says yes, boolean true, then you can call iterator dot next to get the next element. And after you got the next element, then the pointer of the data structure or the iterator is increment by one. So it points now to the next element. And then you ask the iterator again, do you still have the next element? Yes, and so on. And at the end, the pointer doesn't have or doesn't point to an element because you iterate through all elements, and then the iterator has next is false, and you leave the while loop and you iterated over or through all elements of the data structure. This is the iterator use with a while loop. you may use it in a for loop. It's exactly doing the same thing, but in two different ways. So in the for loop, you can also create, first of all, you create the iterator E, and the for loop runs as long as this expression is true, I dot has next. And within the for loop, you say e dot next to get the next element and to increment the pointer to the next element. And the for loop runs as long as this expression is true. So that's the for loop. In my opinion, the while loop is a bit easier to read, and it's nicer. But yeah, it depends on how what you want, or what do you like. But as the for each loop was announced in Java 5, you don't need to use the iterator anymore. So you can now write this for loop for each loop, and the syntax looks like that on the right side you have the data structure you want to iterate through, then you have the two points here, and on the left side you have one single element, in this case string. And then the for each loop iterates through all the elements like here above or here. And you have the same work. All three loops do the same work. But as you can see, the for each loop is the shortest one. And so I would say the for each loop is a syntactical abbreviation. The question now is what kind of requirement does the data structure on the right side has to accomplish that you may use it in a for each loop? So you can't use any kind of object here in the for each loop. So there's a special requirement on this object, and the requirement is the interface iterable. So every class that should be usable in such a for each loop has to implement the interface iterable. And if you take a look at the interface, what does the interface does? It has a method iterator that is abstract. The A say it's abstract. So your class or your type of data structure that implements the iterable interface has to implement and override an iterator method on its own. And this method has to return an iterator of type T. So yeah, it looks pretty much the same like here. So some iterable dot iterator is called, and then you have iterator and you iterate through the data structure. And for each loop does effectively the same, but you don't see it. So Java does it for you secretly and quietly. So if you do so some with the for each loop and you have some iterable, Java calls the iterator method from the some iterable on its own and so on, and it's exactly the same. So yeah, everything what you need to do if to use the for each loop with a data structure is that your data structure have to implement the iterator or iterable interface, and then you have to override the iterator method. And for each and splitterator are default methods, so they have yet implementations, and you don't have to provide any implementations for these two methods. There's one exception. Arrays is the exception, because arrays aren't normal data types. So there isn't a class array, and that's why an array isn't able to implement the iterable interface. but you can use arrays in the for each loop as well. So some iterable may be an array as well, and this is also allowed. So you have either arrays or data structures or objects which implements the iterable. So let's have a look at an example. In my case, I did the code is in one surrounded class, and in this surrounding class has an embedded class. It's a private static class, my string container. And what does my string container? My string container has a list of strings, and you can add strings to this container. It's a simple straight data structure where you can add strings to it. And this string my string container should be able to be used in a for each loop. So it has to implement the iterable interface. And why because we do this, we need an iterator method. And in this case, I've made it a quick way. I am using the iterator of my internally data structure to store the strings from my string container. I am using internally the simple list, in this case an array list, and every list has an iterator. So I can use the list iterator to iterate over my string container. And to do so, I am creating a string container, an empty string container. I add two strings to it, and then I am allowed to use it in a for each loop. So I can write my string container and a string s and iterate through all the strings in my string container. If you want to take a look on the old way, it would looks like this. You have my string container, you can call the iterator method, you get a string iterator out of it, and then you iterator has next and iterator next, as we saw here at the first slide of the code. So let's have a quick look at the example. So we are in question 10. And if I would delete the implements iterable from my string container, then I don't need to override the iterator method. And what kind of error do we get? We get this error: can only iterate over an array or an instance of Java lang iterable. So the for each loop doesn't work anymore, because we aren't implementing the iterable interface anymore, and the error message is clear. You can only iterate either an array or an instance of Java lang iterable. So yeah, you see how to do this. Implements iterable type string in our case, and then we have this method here, iterator. We save it and everything is fine. All right, that's how a for each loop works. The last question in this course is an add-on question, and I've added it because in the past I've read it very often the wrong way, or people claimed the wrong things about the fact if Java is a pass-by-reference or a pass-by-value language. And so this question is always also on Stack Overflow, but I don't know the exact position regarding the most viewed question. But anyhow, I want you to know what is right, and I want you to be able to respond this question the right way in the future. So let's have a look at the both terms, passed by reference and passed by value. Me personally know these two techniques with the term call by reference and call by value, but it means the same. Pass by reference and call by reference, it is the same. So let me tell you first that Java is always and only call by value. So if you are only familiar with Java, you don't know call by reference technique. So yeah, Java is only call by value. This is very important. What is call by reference, or what does both techniques mean? Both techniques appear when you are invoking a method and you want to pass a parameter to this method. So you have created an object beyond the method and have a reference to this object, and then you pass the reference to the method, and the method do anything with it, with the object or the reference, the object where the reference is pointing to. Yes. And call by reference means that you are passing an explicit reference to the reference, to the method. So you have a pointer that points not to the object itself, but to the reference of the object, yes? And call by value means that you, if you are invoking the method with a parameter, the parameter of the method is a copy of the reference of the object beyond the method. So let's have a look at both techniques. We start with call by value because Java is call by value. In Java you can pass either primitive types or real wrapper object types to the method, and the easy way to demonstrate it is for primitive types. So let's start with primitives. We are creating an int variable with the value 0, and then we are calling or invoking a method and pass the int variable in it. And in this, what does this do? Because Java is call by value, it is copying the value of I, the variable I, to the variable param I. So if we are invoking the increment method, param I and I do have the same value, null. And then within the method, param I is incremented by 1. So now param I is 1. But because we copied the value, a variable I isn't affected by this incrementation. So after the method run through, we are system out print line the variable I, and it is still 0, yeah? Because Java is call by value and param I is just a copy of I and not the reference of I. So this is how Java works with primitive types. I think it's easy to understand. A bit more confusing is if you are working with objects. So what is Java doing here? In line 9, we are creating an object and the reference 01 on this object. Then on our working storage on the heap, it is creating an object 1 and a reference 01 that points to this object 1. And now we are system out print line this, and Okay, it says, all right, this object with the hash code, all right. So now we are invoking method with passing 01 as parameter. And because Java is called by value, it is copying the value of the reference 01 and call this copy param. So if you are taking a look at how Java works, you see object param, the reference object param is now a copy of the object 01 reference. So what does this mean? Object param and object 01 is pointing to the same object on the heap or the working storage. Yes. So 01 and param are both pointing to the same object. So if we are now reassign the param with a new object, so we are creating a new object in line 2, we are calling the reference 02. What does happen? We are and then we are system of print line the object 02. All right, it has a different hash code, and now we are reassigning the 02 to the param reference. And if we are taking a look inside of Java, what happens? Now, object param, the reference, is pointing to object 2, to our newly created object. And object 1 is still pointing on object 1 in the heap. So if we are leaving the method and we are system of print line 01, it is still the same. It is still has still the same the hash code, the same hash code. Okay, so this is how Java works, call by value. If Java would be call by reference, it would looks different than by call by value for sure. So let's take a look how it would look like if Java would be call by reference. But let me tell you, the code works different. So this example is only for your imagination. And there are languages like C++, for example, where the programmer, where you can decide if you want to invoke a method with call by reference or if you want to invoke a method with call by value. So you have both opportunities. But in Java, you don't have. But yeah, this example should show you how Java would looks like if it would be call by reference. So the example looks pretty much the same like the example earlier with call by value. So we are creating an object and a reference to the object 01 that affects that there is an object in the working storage. And the reference 01 is pointing to the object 1. All right. So we system out print line the object 01 and see, okay, it system out print lines object 1. All right. Now we are calling the method and passing 01 as parameter to it. And if Java would be called by reference, then the parameter called param would be a pointer on the reference 01. So it would looks like this: param within the method is pointing on the reference outside the method 01, and 01 is pointing on object 1. So now we are creating a new object with a new a reference 02. And system out print line this one, and it says, okay, I am object 2. And then we are reassigning the param with 02. So this would affect if param would pointing to 01, that param and 01 is now pointing on object 2. So yeah, with call by reference, you are able to edit or to change references beyond the method within the method. Yes, so O1 is a reference outside the method, and because you are able to pass O1 as parameter with the technique called by reference, you are able within the method to change the reference outside and beyond the method. That would be passed by reference or called by reference, yes? But this is only for your imagination. Java works like this, and you aren't able in Java to change the reference within a method that affects or would affect a reference outside a method. All right, but what you can do in Java is that you can edit the object within a method. So here in this example, we are trying to reassign or to change the reference with a new object. This isn't possible, but because when we are calling the method, it looks like this. Object O1 and object param is pointing to the same object. And now in the method, we are able to edit and to change things in the object one. Yes. And that's, for this case, I have made an example. So what do we do here? We have a class called foo and a private string, str, yes. And here we have a constructor and we pass a string in here and have a setter method where we can set the internal string with a new value. And we have a toString method that returns only the string, the internal string. So now we have two different methods. In the first method, we try to reassign the variable foo with a new object foo. And in the second method, we are only changing the object. So we don't touch the reference, we only change the object by setting a new string. And so we know Java is called by value. So how does Java work? All right, we are creating a foo one reference to a new foo object with the internal string foo one. And we are calling the method foo one. So we are trying to reassign the reference foo. And no wonder it doesn't work. So after the invocation of the method, foo1 is pointing to the object foo1 and to this object with the content foo1, and this is why foo1 is printed. All right, and now we want to change the object. We are calling the method two, and we are here, and now the reference foo1 and the reference foo are pointing to the same object. So it looks like foo1 is pointing to this and foo is pointing to that, yes. And this is why we are able to change something on the object. And so we now set a new string. So we are calling the method setString and we pass as text new string for foo, and this affects that this object called foo1 or referenced by foo1 is changed with the string new string for foo. And if we now system out println foo1, we see all right, new string for foo. So yeah, this is showing you how call by value works. And as I said 100 times before, Java works this way. Java works only call by value. All right, this is it for the question. All right, this is it. This was the course Top 10 Most Viewed Questions on Stack Overflow. I hope you are confident, and I even still more hope that you've learned a lot about Java and its techniques and how Java works. And I would say take care, and maybe one day we see us in another course. Bye bye.